Welcome dear students, welcome to this study session where we are going to study class 8 chapter number 3 history ruling the countryside. It is a very interesting topic, very interesting chapter it is. So let's begin on with the things. Let's first begin with the difficult terms. The first term is Mahal. Mahal doesn't mean, never get confused with the term Mahal, that it's a king's palace. Mahal here in history means a land, a village, you can say. Mahal, a revenue state, the place from where revenue is collected. Revenue is nothing but the tax. So revenue state, which may be a village or a group of village. A village or a group of village is known as Mahal, from where revenue comes or from where revenue is collected. Okay, clear? Another term is plantation. A large by planter. Planter are the person who used to take the forced labor, that means slaves, for working, and they operate the plant. They are taking care of administration of the plantation. So a large farm operated by planter, employing whom? Various forced labor. Forced labor means slaves. Those who are employing slaves for doing the work of plantation are planter. And planter used to work at a place, they used to operate the thing which is known as plantation. Clear? Very simple it is. Slave. What do you mean by the term slave? It is a very easy term. A person who is owned by someone else. Person who is owned or bought by someone else. Somebody is the owner. That means the slave owner. Slave owner is the owner of slaves. So, person who is owned by someone else, that is, say for example, the slave owner. The slave owner is the person who owns slave. And a slave has no freedom. Obviously, slave has no freedom, as you know, and is forced to work for the master. They have no freedom and they were forced to work for the master. This is the meaning of slave. Another term, bigha. The unit of measurement of land. These days also we used to use bigha. Earlier times in Bengal, the British standardized it to about 1/3 of an acre. 1/3 of an acre. 1/3 of an acre is known as bigha. In Bengal it is used. Still it is used. Okay? It was a unit of measurement of land, first thing. And British standardized it to 1/3 of an acre. Okay? And it is generally used in the states of Bengal. Bigha is very common term. Vat. What is word? Vat? A storage vessel or a fermenting vessel. Fermenting storage vessel. A vessel which is used for storing up of things is known as vat. Fermenting. What do you mean by the term fermenting? In science also you have read fermentation. Fermenting. That means when something is decomposed in the absence of oxygen, as you might be knowing, right? So, fermenting vessel or a storage vessel is known as vat. These are the terms, easy terms. These are very simple terms. If you are going to look for once or twice, it will be quite easy. Now, moving on ahead with the story. The story begins when Bengal was made the Diwan. Now, you might be wondering what is Diwan or what do you mean by the term Diwan. Here is the heading, the company becomes the Diwan. Company was made Diwan of Bengal. Story begins. Diwan. What do you mean by the term Diwan? Diwan means financial administrator or one who takes care of money things. Or you can say, if I am getting the money, from where to take the money, where to invest it. One who takes care of all those revenue system, one who takes care of all those financial matters are known as administrators, financial administrator, which means Diwan. So the story begins in this fashion. The company becomes the Diwan, that means East India Company. On 12th August 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the East India Company as the Diwan of Bengal. So on 12th of August 1765, the Mughal Emperor has appointed the East India Company as the Diwan of Bengal. That means East India Company or the Britisher will take care of whole Bengal, they start looking for making more and more money. They start looking for making more and more profits. For making profit, what they have done? Revenue for the company. Revenue means tax, right? So the company made efforts to increase the revenue. They always looking forward to increase the revenue. For that, what they have done? They start buying the cotton and silk clothes as cheap as possible. They start buying the cotton and silk clothes at cheaper price and sell them at higher prices. This is the thing they have done. Moreover, artisans were forced to sell their goods to the company. Artisans, peasants, farmers, or you can say those craft person, craftsmen, they were forced to sell their goods. They were forcing the Britisher. They were forced, in fact, the Britisher forced these artisans to sell their goods at cheaper price and low price. So they were deserting villages. Deserting means emptying, evacuating. So they were emptying the villages. Finally, Bengal economy was facing a deep crisis. Story is very simple. The company becomes Diwan. As soon as they become the Diwan, they start looking for more and more profits. Once they start looking for making more and more profit, they start buying the things cheaply at cheaper price and sell them at higher price, number one. Number two, they were forcing the artisans to sell the goods at low price, at cheaper price. Because of which, these artisans fleeing away from the villages, they leave up the villages. Finally, Bengal economy was facing a deep crisis. As a result, Bengal finance was under deep crisis, just because artisans were leaving the places and agriculture was also not good. Agricultural cultivation collapsed. Moreover, agricultural cultivation, that means agriculture was also being collapsed. They were not growing too much crops. That's why the Bengal economy was in deep crisis or got ruined up. The economy of the Bengal got ruined up. Moreover, in the year 1770, the biggest disaster, one of the biggest disaster of the history, a famine came in Bengal, which killed about 10 million people. Famine, the word famine means akal, when you don't have the crops, when you don't have the food to eat, enough food to eat, right? So this thing has happened. Now, what was the strategy of the Britishers? They need to improve agriculture. So the company officials, the Britishers, began to feel that investment in land had to be encouraged, right? They started thinking, no, the investment in land should be made so that we can flourish the agriculture, so that revenue can come. Because artisans were already fleeing away from the villages, so only one source is there for the revenue, and that is agriculture. So they feel, these company officials, East India Company, felt that yes, this investment is to be made in land, and this agriculture needed to be encouraged, and so agriculture had to be improved. Now in the year 1793, the company finally introduced the permanent settlement. This is a very famous term, permanent settlement. What do you mean by the term permanent settlement? By the terms of settlement, the Raja Jamindars, mind you. As for according to permanent settlement, the Rajas and Taludas, kings and Taludas, who were taking care of the whole village or Taluks, were recognized as Jamindar. They were made Jamindar. Now, what was the work of the Jamindar? They were asked to collect rent from the peasants. These Jamindars were asked to collect the rent from peasant or farmer. Time and again this term is coming here, peasant, farmer, and pay revenue to the company, which was fixed permanently. So here you get the answer. What happens in permanent settlement? As per according to permanent settlement, the Rajas and Talukdars were made Jamindars, who used to collect the rent from the farmers or the peasant, and they pay the revenue to the company. company officials or to the Britishers, and because the revenue was fixed, that's why the name is permanent settlement. Suppose if the revenue, I used to say 8,000 rupees is fixed, you have to pay, it is permanent, you have to pay it every month, that means settlement or the revenue is fixed. That's why the name comes permanent settlement. The revenue is fixed, revenue was fixed permanently. Okay, so what was in permanent settlement? The Rajas and Talukdars were made Jamindars. Jamindars' duty was to collect the rent from farmers and pay the revenue to the company. Clear? This ensures regular flow of revenue to the company. Because of this revenue, permanent settlement, there was a regular flow of income or revenue in the company, and at the same time encourage Jamindars to invest in improving the land. Jamindars have another duty to invest in the land. The more they invest, the money they will get, so that they can pay to East India Company or the Britishers. Clear? The problem. Now, what was the problem with this permanent settlement? The Jamindars were not investing in improving the quality of the land. Jamindars were not interested in making an investment in the quality of the land, because they didn't want to invest more and more money to improve the quality of the land more, but they don't have so much money. That's why the Jamindars were not interested in investing in improving the quality of the land. And another problem of this permanent settlement was the revenue fixed was too high for the Jamindars. Revenue which they used to collect from peasant and give it to company officials or the Britisher, this amount was very high here, very high for the Jamindars in fact also. Okay? The company, now the company officials were convinced that the system of revenue had to be changed again to meet growing expenses. Now, because that revenue, that much revenue as per according to the permanent settlement was not coming to the Britishers at regular interval of time, so they were convinced, they thought that this system of revenue needed to be changed in order to meet the expense, in order to meet the growing expense. Another settlement came, Mahalwadi settlement. What do you mean by the term Mahalwadi settlement? Here, Mahalwadi comes from Mahal. Mahal means village. So the collectors went from village to village. Here, the collectors went from village to village to estimate the land revenue that each village had to pay. That means the collector used to go from village to village taking a measuring tape. They used to measure the length, breadth and the size of the village as per according to which the revenue is fixed for certain villages. Clear? Collector went from village to village to estimate, to measure the land revenue. That means how much land one village has as per according to the size of the village, they used to fix the revenue. So it was as per according to Mahalwadi settlement. The charge of collecting the revenue and paying it to company was given to village headman rather than Jamindar. One more difference. Now the collecting of revenue, this work, was given to village headman, to sarpanch or mukhiya, we used to say, rather than Jamindar. Not to Jamindar, but to village headman. So if the question will be asked, what do you mean by, what is the difference between permanent settlement and Mahalwadi settlement? It is very easy to distinguish them. Okay? In permanent settlement, the revenue was fixed. In Mahalwadi settlement, the revenue was not fixed. By the measurement of the village, by the measuring up of land, they used to fix a revenue for a particular village. Moreover, there in permanent settlement, who used to collect the rent? These Jamindars, Rajas and Talukdars, okay, they were considered Jamindar and they have the duty of collecting the rent. But here in Mahalwadi settlement, who used to collect the rent? It was village headman or the sarpanch who used to collect the rent and give it to company officials. Clear? Very simple it is. Mahalwadi settlement and permanent settlement. Now, these two types of settlement, Mahalwadi settlement and permanent settlement, these were taking place in North India. What about South India? The Munro system, this was the system of collection of revenue. The new system that was devised came to be known as Riyodhwar or Riyodhwari. Another name of Munro system was Riyodhwar or Riyodhwari. Okay, Riyodhwar scale, which was developed by Thomas Monroe. Because this was the revenue system which was developed on a small scale by Captain Alexander Reed, and it was developed by Thomas Monroe. That's why the name was there as Monroe system. Now, what was there in Rio Tuari system or Monroe system? Rio Tuari system and its problem. Rio Tuari system, the settlement has to be made directly with Rios, and these Rios are nobody but the cultivators, okay, farmers. The settlement had to be made directly with cultivators who had tilled the land for generation. Obviously, they are tilling up their land. So now, in Monroe system, the way of collecting or the settlement is being made directly with the cultivator for rios. So now you got to differentiate between Monroe system, permanent settlement, and Maharwari settlement. Now, what was the problem of the Rio Tuari system? To increase the income from land, revenue officials fixed too high revenue demand. Here also the problem was they have fixed too high revenue for these rios and peasants unable to pay. Peasants unable to pay that high amount, that fixed, that high revenue. As a result, rios fled the countryside. Rios also started escaping from the countryside, and villages became deserted, empty. Okay, villages became empty in many reasons, become deserted in many reasons. Clear? This was the difference between and the problems of permanent settlement, your Mahalwadi settlement, and your Monroe system, okay, or Rio Tuari system, okay. Why demand for Indian indigo? That chapter, one part has got finished up, dear. That types of revenue system, okay, in which we have read about three types of revenue system. The permanent settlement, the Mahalwadi settlement, and the Monroe system. Now, another chapter or another part of it begins the story of indigo and why there was demand of Indian indigo. This was a small story. Because indigo, everybody knows, in Hindi we used to call it neel, right? So indigo was in too much demand. Okay? When indigo was in too much demand, there was a demand for indigo, Indian indigo. Moreover, there was a demand for indigo across the world. By 13th century, Indian indigo was used by cloth manufacturers in Italy, France, Britain to dye the cloth. We used indigo to dye the cloth, to color the cloth, right? So, the indigo was used by cloth manufacturers in Italy, France, Britain, okay? This Indian indigo was being used. The French began cultivating, because the indigo was in great demand, the French began cultivating the indigo in Saint Domingue in Caribbean islands, the Portuguese in Brazil, the English in Jamaica, and Spanish in Venezuela. Okay? The French began cultivating indigo in Saint Domingue in Caribbean islands, Portuguese in Brazil, English in Jamaica, and Spanish in Venezuela. These are some of the areas where they started cultivating or where they started growing the indigo, right? Between 1783 and 1789, the production fell by half. That means in between these years, 1783 to 1789, production collapsed. Production got down. Now, cloth dyers started looking for new source of it. Cloth dyers started looking for another source. That's why the Britain turns to India. Now, Britain thought of India that this is the country where we can grow indigo and we can grow it profitably. That's why they turned to India. The company looked for ways to expand the area under cultivation. The East India Company started looking for the way to expand the area under cultivation. And as a result, by 1810, 95% indigo imported into Britain was from India. Indians have again done it. They have grown the indigo, and the indigo have grown so much that 95% of the indigo, 95% of the world's indigo was imported to Britain from where? From our country, from India. Okay? The story is simple. they started cultivating, European countries started cultivating indigo in these areas, but it got collapsed. So Britain turns to India and they made the Indians to grow the indigo, right? But the main system of indigo cultivation, these are the two types of system that we need to learn, Nij and Yogi. Nij, in Hindi we used to call ourselves Apna, right? And Ryoti, Ryots. Let's try to understand what does this mean. In Nij system, the planter produced indigo in lands that he directly controlled or rented from Jamindars, mind you. In Nij system, the planter produced indigo in their own lands, in lands that he directly controlled. That was belonging to planters that he used to directly control, or they used to take it from rent from Jamindar. Okay? Now, what was the problem with the Nij cultivation? This cultivation required fertile and big lands, and it was difficult to get as they were already populated. The problem with the Nij system is they need more and more land, fertile land. But it was unavailable because our country was populated at that time also densely. So they require fertile and big lands, which was unavailable because the country is already highly populated. Clear? Moreover, availability of tough bullocks, also labor is not available. These things are also not available because it was time for rice cultivation. The season in which this indigo cultivation is being carried forward or is being taken into care is the time of rice cultivation. So these things becomes unavailable, plough, bullock and all these things, as well as labor, because they got interested in cultivation of rice. Then who is going to grow the indigo? This was the problem with the Nij cultivation. Clear? Now, in Ryoti system, what do you mean by the term Ryoti system? Planters forced the Ryot to sign a contract, to sign an agreement, okay? And those who sign the contract or agreement get the cash in advance from planters at low interest. Clear? In Ryoti system, planter forced the labor, forced the farmer to sign a contract, and those farmer who used to sign the contract or agreement will take a cash advance, okay, at low interest. This was Ryoti system. Always remember Ryoti system and Nij system. Okay, clear? Yes. Now, what was the problem with this? The peasant got very low price for indigo. When the indigo grows, they get very low money for the grown indigo. And cycle of loans never end, because they used to take the money in advance at low interest. That's why when they are not getting good prices for the indigo, the cycle of loans keeps on creeping. The debt goes on increasing. After an indigo harvest, you can't grow the rice because indigo reduces the soil fertility. This is another problem. Once the indigo is being grown, you can't grow rice in that part of land. Why you can't grow the indigo in that part? Because it reduces the soil fertility, it hampers the soil fertility. Clear? Now the Blue Rebellion, this is the last topic of this chapter. Write a short note on Blue Rebellion. The question may ask, blue means here indigo, right? Indigo Rebellion, what happened in Indigo Rebellion? Rebellion means revolt against the indigo. So thousands of Ryots refused to grow indigo in March 1859. Thousands of Ryots refused to grow the indigo in March 1859. So there was a revolt against this indigo cultivation because there were too many problems with this growing up of indigo. So they revolted. Ryots refused to pay the rent to planter. They refused to pay the rent to planter and attacked the indigo factories also. Revolt was there from every nook and corner. Okay. So thousands of Ryots refused to grow the indigo. Moreover, they attacked the indigo factories and refused to pay the rent to planters. Now, Riocioso or took an oath or pledge that they would no longer take advances to sow the indigo. They took an oath that they are no more going to grow the indigo also. Because there was so much revolt, the government set up Indigo Commission to look into the matter. Why so much farmers, why so much peasants were revolting over it? The government set up an Indigo Commission. And Indigo Commission also declared that indigo cultivation was not profitable for youths. It is not profitable for the youths, for the peasant, for the cultivator. That's why they are revolting. They have also declared it. Finally, after revolt, indigo production collapsed in Bengal. Indigo production was ruined up, was collapsed in Bengal. Okay, this was a small thing. Now, in Bihar also, Champaran movement. Have you heard about Champaran movement in which Gandhiji went and he has fought in Champaran? Why? Just against this indigo planters or indigo cultivation. Okay, in Bihar, Champaran movement led by Gandhiji in 1917 ended indigo cultivation. Gandhiji has ended up the indigo cultivation over there in Bihar, Champaran area in the year 1917 after fighting against these planters, indigo planters, right? You might have known this thing from the movies also, Gandhi and other movies, I suppose, right? So this was all about the chapter, this chapter. Now because we have some more time left, let's note down your homeworks. And your homework will be, just write down two simple questions, your homework, as a homework, okay? What was the difference? My first question is, just note it down. What was the revenue system? What was the revenue system that we read in? What was the revenue system that we read in this chapter, ruling the countryside? Just note it down fast. Note it down. We read in this chapter, ruling the countryside. Okay, what was the different type of revenue system that we read in this chapter, ruling the countryside? Explain, right? And another question, note it down. What do you mean by the term Bihar? What is Bihar and what is VAT? What is Bihar and VAT? These are the two terms you have to define, okay? So, do it in your homework copy. So, stay home, stay at safe. I am going to keep interacting with you with such classes. It's over for now. Have a nice day. Have a wonderful day. Thank you.